Hello, sports fans, and welcome to the Scott Sports 1 Mile Browns NFL Week 14 early games update show. We're also going to do a Thursday Night Football recap show, and we're going to get to all that, and we'll talk about today's game and the Thursday Night game. But first, here is today's Scott Sports 101 Week 14. That's pretty important. Mr. Brown's TV question. In 1990, who was the backup to the Cleveland Browns, Bernie Kosar? I will have the answer later in the podcast. We'll get to the Browns in just a moment. But first, we're going to recap the Thursday night game. And since we did not get to do a post-game show on Thursday night, so we'll do a... Or yesterday, so we'll do a, it'll be a Thursday night recap show. But, the wins used to come so easy and so often for David Andrews early in his career with the New England Patriots. The veteran center barely noticed them. That hasn't been the case in 2023, not with the franchise enduring its worst season in nearly a quarter century, and with potentially seismic changes looming. So yeah, there was a sense of relief after a 21-18 win over Pittsburgh on Thursday night, a throwback of sorts to the Patriots' many big wins over their longtime AFC rival. Albeit with lesser stakes. The offense has looked lost for a month, gained some momentum behind Bailey Zappi's 3 touchdown passes. The defense got the stops when necessary, and New England, who's now 3-10 on the season, ended a 5-game losing streak while damaging Pittsburgh's increasingly brittle playoff hopes. No one has quit in this locker room, said Andrews, a 2-time Super Bowl champion. We're fighting, we're working, we're trying to get better. That's all you can do. That's all you can ask for. It hasn't been perfect. And no, it hasn't. But that didn't stop the Patriots from coming into Ashkir Stadium and doing something that's become routine through years, changing the trajectory of Pittsburgh's season, and not for the better. Not for the better either. And not for the better. The Steelers, who fell to 7-6 on the season, lost to a two-win team, at home for the second time in 5 days, dropping them out of the top spot in the AFC wildcard race. This stings Pittsburgh coach Mike Tomlin said, but we will be back. Maybe the Steelers play 3 of their final 4 games on the road, all of them against playoff contenders. Hunter Henry had 2 touchdown catches for New England. Ezekiel Elliott had 140 yards from a scrimmage, 72 receiving, 68 rushing, and caught a TD for the NFL's lowest scoring offense, which reached the end zone 3 times for the first time since October. Juju Smith-Schuster added 90 yards receiving against the team he starred for earlier in his career. It means a lot Smith-Schuster said, Smith-Schuster said, you know, honestly, you know, starting my crew here and coming back here and getting a W, I love being on this side of the ball. I'll tell you that. It's a side of the ball New England has rarely been on in 2023. The losses have piled up at a rate since Coach Bill Belichick's first season in 2000. That was six Super Bowls and nearly a quarter of a century ago. Excuse me. For 3 hours on Thursday night, the Patriots found a way to do what they so frequently have done against Pittsburgh, make all the plays that matter. Belichick improved to 15-4 against the Steelers and 10-3 against Tomlin in this latest matchup. Between the league's two longest tenured coaches. Belichick coached his 507th game, moving him past George Halas into the second place all-time behind Don Shula, 526. But it's hardly a guarantee he'll be back for another season with the Patriots. New England has totaled 13 points in his previous three games. The Patriots have exceeded that in the first half with Zeppi hitting Elliott for an 11-yard score before finding Henry in the end zone twice to build a 21-3 lead, their largest of the season. Normally, stoic Zeppi, let those let loose when Elliott scored on the game's first possession, the first time all year New England has reached the end zone on its opening possession. It's really hard to score touchdowns in the NFL, Zeppi said. You've got to celebrate each one. Touchdowns have been nearly as difficult to come by this season in Pittsburgh, yet the Steelers have remained in the mix thanks to a large part of their defense and an ability to thrive in tight games. Pittsburgh, however, lost two of its last three one-score games after winning its first six to start the season. Mitch Trubisky completed 22 of 35 for 190 yards, passing for a touchdown and running for another while filling in for an injured Steelers starter, Kenny Pickett. Trubisky also threw in ill-advised pass in the first half that was picked up to set up the first of Henry's two scores, and he inexplicably threw deep to a well-covered Deontay Johnson on fourth and two at midfield with just under 2 minutes left. Pittsburgh got the ball back with 15 seconds remaining, but had no realistic chance to score. I'm sorry about that. Realistic chance to score. The Steelers managed 264 yards at offense, another setback for a group that briefly seemed on the verge of getting it together after offensive coordinator Matt Canada's firing before Thanksgiving. Pittsburgh piled up 421 yards the following week at Cincinnati, but offensive regressed in Sunday's loss to Arizona, which was not last week, but the week before. Patriots, five days removed from a shutout loss to the Chargers, in which they failed to reach the end zone, let alone the end zone, looked far sharper against a team that stressed it wouldn't overlook another Also, Ran, it happened again anyway. Now, the Steelers did have some injuries. Offensive linebacker Alex Highsmith left in the second quarter with a neck injury. And rookie Nick Herbig played the majority of the snaps in Highsmith's absence. Now, up next, Pittsburgh host Patrick Mahomes and the Kansas City Chiefs in a game that was moved to Monday night from the Monday night time slot to Sunday, December 17th. And the Steelers visit fellow AFC wildcard contender Indianapolis. And that's next Saturday on the 16th. We start Saturday NFL football next week. So this was just one of those games where the home team was not able to get the win, and the road team got it, which was the Patriots. So I give the game balls to the Patriots. Bailey Zappe, 19 of 28, carries and attempts, 240 yards, 3 touchdowns, 1 interception. Ezekiel Elliott, 68 yards, 22 attempts, and that was rushing and receiving, 7 receptions, 72 yards, 1 touchdown. Trubisky and the rushing part and the passing part of it had 22 of 36 carries and attempts, 190 yards, 1 touchdown, 1 interception. And the rushing part of it, 8 attempts, 30 yards, 1 touchdown. And Deontay Johnson, 3 receptions, 57 yards, 1 touchdown. But Pittsburgh just came up short, and they just could not make the plays to get the win. And right now, it's week 14 of the NFL regular season. And the Browns are taking on the Jacksonville Jaguars. And right now, they lead 21-7 in the third quarter with 9:39 left to go. And the Browns are about to kick off. Donnie Watson report. It was a snap to Kareem Hunt. Left guard for the 4-yard touchdown. And Dustin Hopkins' extra point was good. And that's where we stand right now. I'll recap that in just a moment. It's week 14 of the NFL regular season. The Browns take on the Jacksonville. I'm checking on Jacksonville right now at Cleveland Browns Stadium today. And they're coming off a 36-19 loss at the hands of the LA Rams last week. Flacco looked good in his debut, but too many penalties and turnovers. That's what cost the Browns the game. And Joe Flacco has to start in place of DTR, the injured Dorian Thompson-Robinson, the rookie quarterback who was on concussion protocol. Trevor Lawrence will play despite his high ankle injury last week with the Jaguars against the Browns today. Lawrence knows what he and his teammates need to do against the Browns today to get the win. And there's no sign of issues regarding his sprained ankle injury he suffered last week. Signed 3 weeks ago. Joe Flacco has gone from couch to contention. Signed 3 weeks ago by Cleveland as an emergency protection when Deshaun Watson was lost with a season-ending shoulder injury. Flacco had a chance to get the Browns into the playoffs. Has a chance to get the Browns in the playoffs, excuse me. A scenario not even he could have imagined. It's inner grading. For sure, it's exciting, Flacco said. That's what you want. Flacco is expected to make his second start for Cleveland today, and he's doing that. Who are 7-5, looking to go to 8-5, and with us hosting Jacksonville, and who are dealing with their own major issue at quarterback after Trevor Lawrence suffered a high ankle sprain, as I mentioned, against Cincy last week, and they're coming off a 34-31. Shocking overtime loss to the Bengals last week. Though hobbled, Lawrence managed to practice some this week, leaving open the possibility he'll play in a game with major AFC postseason implications. If he can't, the Jaguars will start backup C.J. Beathard, who played two series Monday night after Lawrence went out. Who's ever rolling, will look to go full speed ahead, Jaguars tight end Evan Engram said. It's a big game for us. It's a big game. We've got to go win. We're on the road against a good team, and we've got to be ready no matter who's up. If this was a wild card game, you could bet that Lawrence, who returned to play just 4 days after spraining his knee in week six, would be on the field. And truthfully, this game has major playoff vibes. Browns currently hold one of three wild card spots, but their grip isn't nearly as tight after dropping road games in Denver and Los Angeles the past 2 weeks. Another slip-up could put their playoff chances in serious peril and jeopardy, making the matchup with Jacksonville almost a must-win. And this is a game the Browns need to win. Same for the banged-up Jaguars, who lead the AFC South by one game over Indianapolis, who are 7-5. And Houston, who was 7-5, it hasn't helped that Jacksonville has been smashed by injuries, losing Lawrence, wide receiver Christian Kirk, and left tackle Walter Little on Monday after a tight end, and left tackle Cam Robinson went down. It's a violent sport we play, Engram said. It's unfortunate for our guys or anybody to get hurt, but that's the nature of the game, the nature of this league. It's truly a next man up mentality. It's not a slight or jab at guys that can't go. It's just the nature of the league. You've got to be ready. If somebody ahead of you goes down, Flacco has been down this road before with Baltimore, and he's looking forward to playing in a stadium he knows well as a visitor and with so much on the line. Last season, the 38-year-old Flacco helped rally the New York Jets from a 13-point deficit in the final two minutes to shock the Browns. That was in a September game. It's December. And the stakes are much higher. Flacco, who passed for 254 yards last week in his first game in nearly a year, said, "There is something special about playing in Cleveland, where he is 9-2 as a starter. You smell the grass. It just feels like football," said Flacco. "That's kind of always the stadiums that have kind of been attractive to myself. Smell the grass and feel like it's football weather. And that's the time of the year we are in." We're in December. We're in Cleveland, and it should be a lot of fun. Myles Garrett's injured left shoulder might be slowing him. Cleveland's top-ranked defense has no excuses. Garrett didn't record a tackle last week, and the Browns failed to record a sack for the second straight game, as streak coordinator Jim Schwartz said must end. "That's not us," Schwartz said. "We're built that way. We have a lot of talent up front, and we're at our best when we can generate pressure with a four-man rush. It starts with Garrett, the all-pro edge rusher, who was double and triple teamed in last week's loss to the Rams. Well, he is not worried about Garrett," Schwartz said. "The rest of his defensive front, has to step it up. We expect our D-line to be the driving force of our defense, he said. Their engine that drives us, we have to get back into blocking the quarterbacks and to building everything off of our four-man pass rush. And Jaguars coach Doug Peterson and Schwartz know each other well as any two coaches in the league. Schwartz and Peterson, defensive coordinators in Philadelphia for 5 seasons, 2016 to 2020. They won 46 games together, including the Super Bowl following the 2017 season. That familiarity could be both good and bad. Just knowing him and how he coached and how he coached our defenses in Philly, you kind of know the structure a little bit. Peterson said he's changed some things schematically over his time, but he's got a talented defense right now, and they are playing really good. And Jacksonville is the only NFL team with a perfect road record this season here and abroad. Jaguars are 4-0 in true road games and 6-0 away from EverBank Stadium in a spotless mark that includes consecutive victories against Atlanta and Buffalo in London last month. Jacksonville already locked up its first winning road record since 2007. That was a point of emphasis in training camp we talked about, something we needed to get better at, Lawrence said. We've got to keep that going. Obviously, it's a big road game. We're going to be playing in big road games to finish this year that you're going to have to win. This is a good challenge for us this week. And that is absolutely true. And right now, it's 21-7 Browns, 6:52 left to go in the third quarter. And right now, the Jaguars have the ball. It's 6:39 left to go in the third quarter. And right now, I'm going to recap where we stand right now. I'm going to recap what we've had so far. First quarter. The Browns scored their first touchdown of the game. It was Najee Harris. Najee Harris, and it was a Joe Flacco pass deep left, to David Njoku for the 34-yard touchdown. And Dustin Hopkins' extra point was good, and it was 7-0 Browns. Jacksonville had to go at the punt after going 3-and-out, 3 plays, 7 yards, and the Browns had the punt after going 3-and-out, 3 plays, 2 yards, and Jacksonville 2 yards, and then Jacksonville had the punt again after going 3-and-out, 6 plays, 40 yards. Then the Browns had to punt again after going 3-and-out, 3 plays, 4 yards. Then the Jacksonville, it was 3 plays, no yards for the Browns, and Jacksonville had to go 3-and-out after 3 plays and 4 yards. The Browns had to go 3-and-out, had to punt again after going 3-and-out, 3 plays and 1 yard. Jacksonville then had to go 3-and-out, had to punt after going 3-and-out, 5 plays and 12 yards. Then, just before with 1:25 left in the first, the Browns scored their second touchdown of the game. Joe Flacco passed short right to David Njoku for a 30-yard touchdown. 30-yard touchdown. Dustin Hopkins' extra point is good, and it was 14-0 Browns at the end of the first quarter. In the second quarter, Jaguars had an interception, and it was Trevor Lawrence pass deep left and intended for Zach Jones, intercepted by Martin Emerson at the Cleveland 25 for no gain. And then the Browns got the ball back, but then they had an interception. Joe Flacco's pass short left intended for Cedric Tillman, intercepted by Dari Williams at the Jacksonville 31. Pushed out of bounds for at the Jacksonville 42 for 11 yards. And then the Jaguars got the ball back, and they went three and out, had the point after going three and out, 6 yards, six plays, 13 yards. And then the Browns had a fumble. It was Joe Flacco passed right to Amari Cooper to the Cleveland 22 for 17 yards. And then Weingart fumbles and recovered by Jacksonville. And Lloyd got the ball at the Cleveland 25, pushed out of bounds at the Cleveland 12 for 13 yards. And then Jacksonville scored their first touchdown of the game. Trevor Lawrence passed short right to Evan Engram for a 10-yard touchdown. Brendan McManus's extra point was good, and it was 14-7 Browns. And the Browns had to go three and out after going three and out. Three plays, -2 yards. And then Jacksonville had a second interception in this game in the second quarter. Trevor Lawrence passed deep left intended for Ridley at the intercepted by Martin Emerson at the Cleveland 8. Emerson ran out of bounds at the Cleveland 19 for 11 yards. And the Browns got the ball back, but then they had to punt after going three and out. Five plays, 18 yards. And Cincinnati had the Jacksonville had the punt, excuse me, after going three and out. Three plays, no yards. Then the Browns had the punt again after going three and out. Five plays, 20 yards. And then at the end of the first half, Trevor Lawrence nears to Jacksonville 20 from -1 yard. And it was 14-7 at halftime. And in the third quarter, the Browns scored their third touchdown of the game. It was a snap to Kareem Hunt, left guard for the 4-yard touchdown. Dustin Hopkins' extra point is good, and it was 21-7. Browns is the scores right now. Jacksonville had the punt after going three and out, three plays, no yards. And the Browns had another fumble, their second one of the game. That's not good to have happen, boys. You got to stop those fumbles. It was Joe Flacco sacked at the 25 for -8 yards, and Johnson fumbled it. And it was fun. Touched to the Cleveland 29, recovered by Jacksonville. Ledbetter is at the Cleveland 25 for no gain. And then now in the current drive, and it was a first and 10. Trevor Lawrence passed short middle to Evan Engram to the Cleveland 15 for 10 yards. And then it was first attempt to Cleveland 15. Direct snap to Elaine, left tackle to the Cleveland 17 for -2 yards. And then Trevor Lawrence pass incomplete, deep left to Ridley, and that was for no gain. At 3-12 at the Cleveland 17. Trevor Lawrence pass short left to Ridley, pushed out of bounds at the Cleveland 1 for 16 yards. Then it was a first and goal. Trevor Elaine. Right guard for the Cleveland 1 for no gain. And then the Jacksonville just scored a touchdown, and it was a team right guard to the Cleveland 1 for no gain. And then it was Jacksonville challenged a short of the goal line. And the play was reversed. Shotgun direct snap to Etienne, to team right guard for the 1-yard touchdown. And Mitchell was injured during his play. His return is probable. And the extra point was good, and it's 21-14 Browns. So, Browns, you need to score right now. You need to do it, and they've got the ball. They're going to have it because Jacksonville's about to kick off. So, and right now, that's where we stand right now. We'll get to the picks of the week in a moment. Right now, it is time to reveal the answer to today's Scott Sports 101 Browns NFL Week 14 trivia question. And here it is. One more thing. In 1990, who was the backup for the Brown for quarterback to the Cleveland Browns, Bernie Kosar? And if you said Mike Pago, you are correct. Mike Pago was the backup quarterback to the Cleveland Browns quarterback Bernie Kosar in 1990. I'll have another trivia question on my next podcast, so stay tuned for that. And right now, we're going to quickly do the picks of the week. My brother-in-law Eric Hoyle and I both took Pittsburgh and lost because they lost to New England, so we're both 0-1. The Houston Texans are playing the New York Jets right now, and they find themselves down 21-6 at MetLife Stadium in New York. They've been limited to 2 field goals today so far. They're in the fourth quarter with 8:47 to go. I've got Houston, and so is my brother-in-law, Eric Hoyle. He's got the Texans as well. The LA Rams are taking on the Baltimore Ravens at M&T Bank Stadium in Baltimore. And it's 22-20. Baltimore is the ball right now with 2:05 left in the third. And it's the first and 10 at the Baltimore 1. And I've taken Baltimore, and so is my brother-in-law, Eric Hoyle. The Carolina Panthers are battling the New Orleans Saints at Mercedes-Benz Superdome in New Orleans, and right now they are the Panthers are down 14-6. New Orleans has the ball, first and 10 at New Orleans 36, fourth quarter 8:12 to go, and I have taken New Orleans. And so does my brother-in-law, Eric Hoyle. He has taken New Orleans. The Indianapolis Colts are taking on the Cincinnati Bengals at Paycor Stadium. And they find themselves down 31-14. Fourth quarter, 9:37 to go. First and goal to Cincinnati 20. Colts have the ball. I've taken the Cincinnati Bengals. So is my brother-in-law, Eric Hoyle. Atlanta Falcons is taking on the Tampa Bay Buccaneers right now at Mercedes-Benz Stadium in Atlanta. Tampa Bay is up on Atlanta 19-17, and the Bucs are about to kick off, so I think Atlanta's going to have the ball. It's 11-10 left to go in the fourth quarter, and I've taken Atlanta. My brother-in-law has taken Tampa Bay, and that's one that we don't agree on. And for the Browns game at Browns Stadium today, I've taken the Browns. My brother-in-law has taken the Jaguars. Those are the only two that we don't agree on. Those are only two this week. Detroit Lions, rounding out the other games, are taking on the Chicago Bears at Soldier Field in Chicago. And they find themselves trailing 25-13, fourth quarter, 14-12 to go. First and 10 at the Detroit 25. Detroit has the ball. Those are the early games. Now for the late games that will be played later on, the Seahawks will take on the 49ers at Levi's Stadium. And I've taken the 49ers, and so is my brother-in-law, Eric Hoyle. He's also taking the 49ers. The Minnesota Vikings take on the Las Vegas Raiders in Allegiant Stadium in Las Vegas. I've taken the Vikings, and so is my brother-in-law, Eric Hoyle. The Kansas City Chiefs will take on the Buffalo Bills at Arrowhead Stadium, and hopefully they can bounce back. They have been struggling. I've taken the Chiefs, so is my brother-in-law, Eric Hoyle. The LA Chargers are taking on the Chargers are taking on the Denver Broncos at SoFi Stadium in Inglewood, California, near Los Angeles. I've taken the Chargers, so is my brother-in-law, Eric Hoyle. Sunday Night Football. Philadelphia Eagles and the Dallas Cowboys will square off at Big D tonight, and that's going to be a doozy of a game. But despite they're playing in Big D, I've taken Philadelphia, and so has my brother-in-law, Eric Hoyle. And we have 2 Monday night games this week. The Green Bay Packers are taking on the New York Giants at MetLife Stadium in East Rutherford, New Jersey. And I've taken Green Bay, and so has my brother-in-law, Eric Hoyle. And rounding them out, the Tennessee Titans are taking on the Miami Dolphins at Hard Rock Stadium. And they're 13-point favorites. And I have taken Miami, and so has my brother-in-law, Eric Hoyles. So it's a 35 of the Jacksonville 44. The Browns have the ball, 21-14. A minute and a half left to go in the third quarter. Well, that's just about going to wrap it up for the Scott Sports 101 Browns NFL Early Games Update Show and TNF Recap Show. I'll be back with the Early Games Post Game Show and Late Games Pregame Show once the games between all the early games have concluded, including the Browns and Jaguars. But until then, always remember, be a team player each and every day in every way possible. So long, everybody. 3, 2, 1. I'm done.